They're not in a position right now to win their division.
Right.
So it's getting tight for them, and some of the teams in front of them have already beaten them, like us. Not right. that we're going to lose our division, but if it fell apart on us and it was a tiebreaker, we still beat the Steelers. So I think this was a game I think they really had to have. They blew. I don't say blew. They lost a tight game.
Right.
And, that happens in the NFL all the time. On the bad side for Kansas City, I think it's the same old Kansas City. Lots of penalties. Not as much as last week. Last week was just ludicrous. But, still 6 penalties. That's drive killing. And 2-on-13 on third downs. You and I both talked about this earlier. 2 of 13 on third downs is not how to win games. That's how, your score is going to be low. And they lost. And the penalties lead to third and longs. And when you got a quarterback who really can't pass out of that consistently, your drives are going to stall and you're not going to score a lot of points.
All right, so next game. Let's talk about the Oakland-Baltimore game.
Oh, my God.
Okay, now, first off...
Sorry. I'm not done.
You're not done laughing yet. Okay.
Okay,
well,
I'm up.
That ended up being a 20-55 blowout, although I'm going to hang a Barry Bonds asterisk on that. I call it at 21-24, so I wasn't that off on Oakland, but good Lord, Baltimore, where the hell did they get 55 points offense? I mean, the thing about it is that half a dozen pundits talked about how Baltimore, in their last 5 wins, had combined only managed a 23-point surplus in 5 games.
Yeah, that's true.
So, how do they manage, a 25-point blowout?
And so we can finish the board up here, I called 6-27.
Okay.
So you called 21-24, I called 6-27. We did call the winners, but we didn't even get close on points. I think we both get a meh.
Yeah.
Meh. It's unfortunate, but there it is. getting back how did Baltimore rack up some points? It's Joe Flacco. He's such an inconsistent quarterback. Speaking of inconsistency, the guy claims he's one of the best quarterbacks in the league, and you'll see him one game, it's like, man, he's really good. He can drop the ball anywhere. And the next game, he can't throw it to anyone. So Joe Flacco really kicked out. For that game, I said Ray Rice was going to be the factor, that Oakland's running defense couldn't stop anybody. But it turned out nobody could run in that game.
No.
And Ray Rice wasn't a factor. And so it just turned into this huge passing, every third play was the bomb kind of situation. Interestingly enough, in the press, Flacco's getting a lot of credit for the win. But Palmer had a good game. And if you're going to say anything good about Oakland this game, you can say, hey, Palmer had a good game. He didn't throw to a lot of, there wasn't the, he's throwing to where the receiver should be as opposed to where he is. That didn't really happen a lot that game.
Right.
So I think that's something they can build on. But, to flip it over, in my mind, this was the same on Oakland again.
Well,
good.
Well, I was just going to say, statistically, we've got a thing where, Oakland had 19 first down. Baltimore had 22. Third down conversions, they were about the same, which was kind of, so-so. 8-18 for Oakland, 5-12 for Baltimore. Passing yards, they were virtually the same, 350 and 41. Rushing, 72 and 78. Turnover, and then a really bizarre thing is time of possession. Oakland had 33 minutes of time of possession. Baltimore had 26 time of possession. Now, so where did it fall apart? Well, where it fell apart is their sloppiness.
Yep.
I mean, good God, 10 penalties for 105 yards. There's no team in the league that can win a game with 10 penalties.
We can't win it consistently. I completely agree. And we've talked about this. Well, this would be the third week. It's an institutional problem with the Raiders.
Right.
It's kept them from having success, or even the chance of success, year after year after year, all the way from, since John Madden left the team. They just have to fix that, or they won't be competitive. Another stat that popped up for me, after the game was they're in the red zone 3 times, no touchdowns. You can't win football games in that situation. And Baltimore was much better there.
Right.
So.
Well, and then, of course, there are 3 turnovers.
Yes, that doesn't help you.
2 fumbles and an interception and, especially, Baltimore's a team where you expect to lose the ball. I mean, it's been one of their specialties for, going on a decade.
Yeah,
to,
their defense is ferocious. Balls
and intercept. But, man, Oakland got owned on that.
They couldn't protect Palmer, 3 sacks.
Right.
I just wrote down my notes, same old Oakland.
Right.
What are you going to do? I don't know if we have to spend much more time on this game. And that was, if you're a Baltimore fan, that was great. If you're an Oakland Raiders fan, well, it's just more of the same.
Right.
We didn't expect them to win. And the fact that they lost by a mile, it really doesn't change my opinion of either team. Baltimore's still streaky. Oakland is just still bad from the fundamentals perspective. Chargers and Bucks. And this game was kind of back and forth. You had called it with 34-37.
Right.
And I had called it 23-21. And this is actually the first time that we've disagreed on a pick for the winner.
Right.
And the final score was 24-34. So you actually picked the winner, and you were actually pretty close on points. That was a very impressive pick. I picked it backwards and had the wrong number of points. So,
you know, I actually thought that it was going to be almost a replay of the Oakland-Tampa Bay game, but I thought that Phillip Rivers would have his pride in the game, would have his back up, and really be trying to throw a lot more touchdowns. I'm surprised that they were contained at only 24 points.
We talked about that last week, actually. And again, this is just like Oakland. This is something we've been talking about for 3 weeks now, which right. is the consistency of Phillip Rivers, the maturity of Phillip Rivers, you know, to do the right thing on the field.
Right.
And now we've kind of grouped him in the class of quarterbacks like Tony Romo, who just, if they play their game, they're very good players, but they're not disciplined enough to play consistently good games. So this was a game where I bet that Phillip Rivers, with their back to the wall as far as standings, would finally play a consistent game, and he didn't, and that flipped the pick right into your lap. So I felt that this game was actually really back and forth. You know, either team could have won this game, and it was a tough fought game. And actually, our picks kind of reflect that. I gave him a 2-point win, for the Chargers, and you gave the Bucks a 3-point win. Mm-hmm. So we felt it was going to be a tight game, and it was all the way down. You know, teams, they swapped the lead a couple times, but once again, this game hinged on Phillip Rivers.
Yeah,
and immature play. He threw that first interception in the fourth quarter that was returned for the touchdown that gave the Bucks a 10-point lead. That was the winning score. They never came back from that.
In fact, I mean, again, let's talk about these statistics.
Sure.
Because this has really been the story of this this week for me. First down, San Diego had 23 first downs to Tampa Bay's 12.
23 first downs in a game where you get, you know, on the average between 50, somewhere between 50 and 60-ish
yes.
offensive series or plays.
Uh-huh. That's a crazy good day,
sure.
You know. Third downs, we've got 10 for 15 on third downs. I mean, a two-thirds conversion rate on third downs is a great day for any team.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And, you know, Tampa Bay, 3 for 9. Passing yards. Phillip Rivers, 323 yards to Tampa Bay's 205. Rushing yards, 103-74. 100 yards rushing is a decent day for an NFL football team.
Absolutely.
And time of possession. This is crazy. 36 minutes and 41 seconds of time of possession for San Diego, and only 23 minutes and 19 seconds for Tampa Bay. So you go, what the hell?
Right.
How did San Diego not win this game? And you know what? Here it is. Turnovers. 2 interceptions. I mean, you know what? Mr. Rivers, I'm going to call you Mr. Rivers just to be respectful, but you really got to realize that every time you point a finger at somebody, you got 3 more pointing back at yourself. Those 2 interceptions were the difference in the game.
Yeah, that was absolutely it. You know, I'll give the Bucks all due credit. They have shown themselves to be a tenacious team. I'm not sure, you know, how far they're going to move along in the NFC South. Listen to this quote. And this is like, this is Phillip Rivers. He's been in the league a long time now. This is not like, hey, this is a first or second year quarterback.
This is not like Dalton or somebody.
Yeah, no, this is like somebody who should know better. After the game, Rivers said to the press, it's a humbling game because it shows how one play, essentially one play, can ruin a game. We killed ourselves on the interception for a touchdown. We were rolling pretty good for most of the game. First off, the imperial use of the we.
Right.
I don't like that in any sport. As an athlete, it was a we when something good happened. When I screwed up, it was I.
Right.
There was no we in that interception that lost in the game. That was Phillip Rivers.
The George Carlin rule applies.
Which is?
Your shite, my stuff.
Oh, yeah, yes. Yes, yes, exactly. So... You know, every professional player in the football league goes to a media training class,
right?
Both from the league's perspective, and the team has their own set of guidelines about what you can and can't say to the press. But generally, you don't use the we on when I screw up. That wasn't like a blocking failure. That was Phillip Rivers sliding out of bounds, seeing a receiver downfield, And as he's running out of bounds, throwing that ball, it's only one place that ball can go. He's not going to throw it the three quarters of the field. Of course, all the defenders are sliding along that spot. Intercepted, pick six, 83-yard return, bomb, the game is over.
Right.
Guess what? That happened last week. You know, Rivers threw the interception in the end zone. It wasn't returned, but it basically, that was what was going to turn that game around for him, and he screwed it up again.
It's an issue of judgment, and you're right. I mean, you know, if he were a first, second, third year quarterback, you know, you could say something about, you know, his inexperience, you know, getting juiced up on adrenaline, making bad choices, sure. Right? But he's not that. He is a veteran quarterback. He ought to know better. Particularly, he ought to know better given the number of times he's done it. Right. There's a highlight reel that's probably 2 hours long of him throwing exactly that kind of stupid interception.
You know, and so, yeah, and it's, and again, I'll compare him to Tommy Romo. You know, the quarterback giveth and the quarterback taketh away. When they're on, they win games for their team. When they're off, they screw it up. But they're inconsistent so much that neither team has any consistency year by year. The only reason that the Chargers make it to the playoffs as much as they have is because the Broncos always fall apart at the end of the season. From the Mike Shanahan era to, well, until the first year of John Fox.
Right.
You know, so they're in a weak division, and they've been lucky. But the reality is if they were playing in a tougher division, you wouldn't see them anywhere.
Right. If they were NFC East or North.
Yeah. That was
sorry, NFC North.
Yeah. They'd be doomed. They'd be out. Yeah, they'd be out in a second. So, again, hey, another game lost by Phillip Rivers.
Right.
Yeah. He wins games, but the problem is that you got a quarterback who wins 3 out of 4 games. Just statistically, you're never going to make it to the Super Bowl.
Right.
Because one of those losses will be in the playoffs.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of a dumb way of putting it, but that's...
So, yeah, just to be consistent. You know, from one week to the next. You know, I'm more of a Carson Palmer fan than I am a Phillip Rivers fan, because while Palmer may not have the skill, he doesn't screw up the same way that Phillip Rivers does. You know, when you look at the undisciplined play of Oakland, it really has to do, it's spread around. I mean, you know, there are many hands making all those penalties and you know, creating turnovers. It's not just Carson Palmer. But you know what? This game for San Diego, I got to lay really the bulk of it right at Phillip Rivers' feet.
I agree completely. You know, it's selfish play. In a team sport, when a single player does the wrong thing and does it not by accident, but does it knowingly, you know, hey, I'm a running back. I'm not carrying the ball high. I'm not shifting to my offhand. Quarterback's throwing passes into places where that's the only place the ball can go. Mm-hmm. That's selfish play, you know, and if it happens even once a game, for a player, it's a bad thing. It can cost teams games. You know, wide receivers who short-arm balls, quarterbacks who throw, you know, Cam Newton, you know, I'm being sacked, so I'm going to just try throwing the ball out. Well, guess what?
Right.
You know, it's the throw's going to have no power. People are going to jump routes. That kind of play kills teams. That's where the team element falls apart, and it's just you got to get the guy in hand.
Well, now, speaking of Cam Newton, we ought to shift over to Denver.
Okay.
Boy, what an interesting game that was.
Yeah, it was.
It was disappointingly interesting, let me just say. Okay, final score was 36-14. I called it at 35-20. John called it at 34-17. Now, I think we both converged on the Broncos score because, you know what? Bottom line is that Manning's Broncos have been pretty consistent about knocking in low 30-point totals.
Yeah.
Except for that Atlanta Falcons
27.
Game. Yeah, exactly.
The one exception to the rule.
So, you know, it's pretty much, it's almost not even a pick to say, okay, they're going to do, you know, 31, you know, 35, you know, something like that.
So we both got that one.
Right.
And we were really close. I mean, that's that was good.
The 20 I picked and the 17 you picked, I mean, I consider those to be, you know, pretty good, solid picks there.
Sure.
I think we overestimated, well, I feel like I seriously overestimated the capability of Carolina. But you know what? Even though this is a win, and even though it's a win roughly in the shape that we were thinking of in terms of the point spread,
right?
My overwhelming biggest concern is the fact that the Broncos went from a minute and 32 seconds left in the first to basically 14 minute at the 14 minute and 17 second mark in the fourth without an offensive score. And it was, and they didn't get a touchdown until there was only 3 minutes left in the fourth. So basically, the Broncos got shut down offensively by Carolina. And that's a problem.
It was.
That's a real problem.
I think, you know, we're going to talk about this in a second, but it's kind of a theme that we've been seeing over the last 2 weeks with the Broncos, where they're having problems running the ball. And that really should not be happening with a Peyton Manning offense, because Manning's passing ability should drive the linebackers out of run protection.
Yes.
Should drive them far enough off the line where the running game can pick up 3, 4, 5 yards consistently when they need those yards.
Yeah, the running. I mean, boy, McGahee was silent again.
Again.
And we're talking about silent in a way that he was being, you know, given the ball, but he was being cut down in the backfield on a regular basis.
Sure.
And, you know, something's getting into his head, because I saw him so many times approach the line of scrimmage with that stutter step that guys have when they're just not confident on what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
I also have questions about the offensive line's ability to, you know, open up lanes for McGahee to run. But there's a basically, as you mentioned, you've got a Peyton Manning pass-heavy offense that should be spreading the field defensively.
Absolutely.
And it's not. For some reason, teams are starting to be able to cue off on where those running plays are coming from.
They are getting personnel reasonably tight to the line of scrimmage.
The offensive line, in my opinion, is not opening up the lanes they should, and McGahee is not looking like the one-cut, downhill-running warrior with churning legs that I love.
And that, I think that right there is really the problem. You know, that has been the Denver's running off philosophy, you know, all the way back to the playoff and Super Bowl years, is one cut and go downhill. You mm-hmm. know, don't spend a lot of time, because zone blocking assignments back in the Shanahan era didn't really allow for a lot of time. So McGahee right now is one of those gap runners. He's bouncing along the gaps trying to find his spot to go through, where McGahee traditionally, back with the Steelers and with us, he would just, oh, okay, there's a linebacker in the gap, fine, I'll drive him.
Mm-hmm.
For the 3 or 4 yards, right. And wear out the offense, and he's really playing that little tenderfoot game of I'm gonna dance around for a bit, shift around, see if I can find if some place is open and go through. Modern NFL doesn't really allow for that very much.
No, it doesn't. In fact, you know, it could be entirely, you know, McGahee's doing, because, you know, of course, these lanes don't stay open very long. They're open a quarter of a second, half a second, right? Yep. And if he's stutter-stepping his way to the line of scrimmage, that could be enough for, you know, the Red Sea to collapse back, you know, on the Pharaoh's people. yeah, I know. Long way to go for the...
That was a great one, though. Yeah. That's awesome.
But you know, that's a real problem. The other thing, too, is I think that they're using him too much. I think they're using McGahee too much.
I agree. Well, I talked about last week they should put Hillman in more. And they put him in for 5 plays, and he averaged a total of 5 yards. Actually, one of those plays was for 5 yards, the touchdown play. So basically, one run, he got 5 yards. The other 4, average 0.
Which is one of the reasons why I have some question, actually, about what the offense.
Yeah, when you switch, like I said last week, why don't you switch the running back and try for speed?
Right.
See if that's the problem. Because it happens sometimes. You're like, this guy's getting nothing. You switch other guys on, bam, it's a 100-yard game for the second, you know, the second tailback. That did not happen here. And so now I'm starting to lean a little bit more towards where you're at, where the offensive line is simply not getting upfield to that second level, getting those blocks on the linebackers that springs out the running back. One thing I will say about the running game is, even though it wasn't working for the Broncos this time, with the play actions, which Manning was doing brilliantly, he's not really known for being a really good play action kind of guy, right. As far as, you know, really hiding it well, or, you know, or really selling it well.
But you know what? Yeah, there was a play like in the third where I remember it, when we were watching it, you made a comment about, you know, good Lord, I thought that the running back had the
I was like, I think even the camera started to follow that. And that's a rare thing when you fool the cameramen who are brilliant at their job. It's like, oh. But the play action plays did drive the linebackers in a bit. You know, they were a little too gritty on the run. So in spite of the fact that we didn't have much of a running game, it did give us some of the ability to do play action passes to get us yards. But the problem, but the lack of the running game really ended up burning us.
Yeah.
Because we were wide on Manning. It put us in a lot of third and long situations. And what did we end up covering, like 3 of 13 third downs?
Yeah. I mean, how we won this game with 3 third down conversions, I really don't know. I mean, well, actually, I do know. I mean, it's the fact that they were able to, you know, get a touchdown out of special teams and a touchdown out of the defense.
One thing that the Denver defense did again, it seemed like, especially in that first drive, is it looked like they came out to play the wrong team again.
Yeah, their defense. They had the wrong defensive sets.
So I'm not like, is it like the week before playbook or whatever? They make great adjustments, but it seems like every week, the opening drive or two, the other team just marches down the field. Sometimes it takes them a half to catch up to what team they're playing.
I would say, actually, that last week was the first time that they had four quarters of football where it seemed like the defense was ready in all four quarters.
That's a fair statement.
This week, it seemed they were back to, you know, having the wrong set. And, again, it's a mystery. I mean, you know, Jack Del Rio is, you know, a good coach. I mean, you know, when he got his head coaching gig, you know, his team, while, you know, struggling a bit, was the number one defense.
You know, again, this is a metagame. And these are the things you'll never know, because these are the secrets you just can't let anybody know, or they become ineffective. So, conspiracy theory. Does Jack Del Rio come out and play for a certain number of plays, has his defense play in very stock basic formations, lets the other side's offense think, oh, you know, this is going to be pretty easy, or, you know, we can run these kinds of plays, and then he just changes it up? Is that going on purpose? Because if so, you're a genius. But if this is, oh, we had the wrong playbook, or we didn't look at the right game film, or other teams are used to playing Jack Del Rio by now, and they know what he's going to do, and he's having to make mad adjustments in the game, that needs to be taken care of during the week. That needs to be taken care of during the coaches' meeting, and when they're assembling what kind of defense they're going to put together. So either he's a genius or an idiot.
Well, you know what? If he's a genius, then he would be a genius on the scale of like a Belichick on the defensive side of the ball, you know? to game the game, to game the game of the game with the game. Yes. Until you're down to the little China doll, or the little Russian doll that's about that big.
Yeah.
You know, that's the game that they're playing.
You know, actually, that's I kind of consider that the play of the game. You know, like with the Broncos, I've been kind of like watching for like, you know, what's the thing that defined that game?
Right.
This is what I consider almost a perfect scoring hat trick. The only thing they didn't do was a two-point conversion on a touchdown. They scored a passing touchdown, a rushing touchdown, an interception for a touchdown, a special teams touchdown, a safety, field goals, two of those.
Right.
The only thing we did, and of course the point after, the only thing we didn't do last week, and you disappointed me again, Broncos, was the two-point conversion after a touchdown. I mean, we scored almost every possible way there was to score in a football game, which is pretty rare.
Your lack of faith disturbs me.
So how did we win this game? You know, as they like to, you know, coaches like to say, you know, we want to play well in all three phases. We played well in all three phases. Should you whip out the song now? The special team song for Holiday?
Holiday! Oh, boy. Yeah, I kept singing that over and over again.
So, you know, I think if you step back from the game, you say, well, how did we win this game? It wasn't our offense. They drove in for, you know, two scores and two field goals. You know, those are good points. But where we won the game was defense, and the fact that every time we got the ball on special teams, Holiday was doing something with it. And they either got his good field position, or on that one play, he broke it for the not touchdown, as I'm going to call it, the touchdown that really should never have been. But except for his stupidity, that was 7 points for us. The defense. You know, the defense beat the crap out of Cam Newton. I saw on ESPN.com that every time that he dropped back, he was harassed 42% of the time.
Right, yeah.
Either hit, sacked, or under duress. We sacked him 7 times. That's insane. The offensive line of the Panthers just could not hold off our base rush.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, we were watching the game. We paused the play, and the it was just standard play. I think the Broncos brought four. They brought the regular three, and they brought Von Miller or somebody in on the edge. So four guys rushing five. All four of the Panthers were closer to the line of scrimmage than the Denver defense, which was closer to the quarterback.
Right.
They just blew literally every player beat their assignment, and then they just humiliated the Panthers, the front five.
And I made this remark during the game. It reminded me of that game last year where Jay Cutler got sacked like what, 7, 8, 9 games,
70 times. I don't know. It was ridiculous. He was on his back a lot. That was a bad, bad game for the Bears.
I mean, the defense. But you know what? As good as they were doing on pass, you know, rush on the passer, of collapsing that pocket, they still were miserable on rush defense and still miserable on. Do you remember that there were a couple of screenplays in that game?
They just
and Carolina just owned our defense on the screenplay.
They did. I think that was the Denver. You know, teams will run the screen to slow down rushing defenses. We were being hyper aggressive, and the screen tends to have success against that. But after a while, you just got to cue on that. You just got to go to the line of scrimmage as a defense and say, they're probably there's the screen is a real potential. You know, one chance in five, they're going to be running a screen. So let's, you know, let's keep an eye out for that. You know, and if you run right by the guy that's supposed to be blocking you, you might want to just kind of keep an eye on and make sure he's not getting out in the flat for a screen pass. Yeah, they burn us on the screen over and over and over again. There's one part, you know, as far as the defense, you know, Cam Newton, we talked about this last week, that Cam Newton is a young quarterback. He's still pretty excitable and emotional in games, and that's one of the things when we were making these calls, whether we're going to get good Cam Newton or bad Cam Newton.
Right.
Well, I'm going to cut him more slack. He's a younger quarterback, and he's not been in the league in a long time. But there were some selfish plays that he threw an interception wide, basically being drugged down to the ground. That was just a give-me pick for an interception. You know, if you're going to throw a pick, at least throw it in the middle of the field where the rest of your players might be able to shut down the run back. You throw it out to the corner there, out to the edges of the field. There's nobody between that guy and the end zone. It's not
right.
You're not going to be able to stop him. But we beat up Cam Newton so bad. I remember one time at the third quarter, they were showing him walking off the field, and he looked like he was 60 years old. He was hobbling. His head was down. I mean, he looked like he'd been beaten up, and he had been.
Mm-hmm. You know, two other things, actually, I'd like to say about this game. One is that I was really surprised by how the entire Broncos receiving core was having an off day. I think I counted Decker having three drop passes that on any other game I would have expected him to reel in. Thomas, I think, dropped two passes that he should have had. And the tight ends, you know, they were quiet.
Sure.
I think there was one really kind of important reception from Dreesen.
Mm-hmm.
And Tammy was just, I don't even remember his name being called. So that's one thing. The other thing is, going back to the running game, I really think that no matter what, they need to start involving Hillman and Ball more. And going back to the, you know, whole fullback business, it might actually be a thing to do. If I were John Fox, which is a completely useless statement, but if I were John Fox, something I would try would be a thing where I would bring in, you know, McGahee and Hillman or McGahee and Ball, and with the full intention that their primary role, Hillman or Ball, would be to run basically a fullback role. But with the option, of course, for
either one to actually get the ball.
Exactly.
Sure.
And I think that might start opening up some space. Plus, it would get them some reps. I mean, keep in mind, I can't remember if it was Hillman or Ball, but one of those two was drafted this year. I mean, we spent a draft pick to pick one of those guys up. So the thing about it is, if we believed in them that much, we should be getting them the reps on the field.
Fair enough. And you know, from the metagame perspective, you know, like last week where they lined up in an obvious, it was a third and short situation, but they lined up with a passing package and then they ran out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And they got the first down, ultimately helped them win the game. And from the metagame perspective, you start loading up with what looks like to be runs,
mm-hmm.
and then you pass out of it.
Right.
It's Peyton Manning.
Well, and the other thing, too, is that, okay, for all the criticism we've given to McGahee, the bottom line is he has been a great receiver.
He's done, yeah. He's.
I mean, he is great in the flat. He is great for reeling off another 5 yards after a short little, you know, dump catch over
sure.
the line.
He's been an excellent outlet receiver. And, you know, in the modern NFL, the tailback has to be able to catch the ball
right.
in the flat. He's got to be the outlet guy. He's got to be able to run the ball. And he's got to be able to pass block. And I think he did all three pretty well. So I guess the last thing probably to talk about in the Broncos game is that Dumerville is questionable for next week. And that will potentially hurt us, so they're not 100% sure if he's going to play right now. He's listed with the big Q. Hopefully he'll be out on the field. No, but that'll help us.
I don't necessarily see Dumerville being injured as a bad thing. I think the Broncos' defense has come to rely a little bit too much on their 1-2 punch of Von Miller and Dumerville. And I think that it may actually improve their rush defense if Dumerville is out, because they're not going to be, the line is not going to be counting on one of their two star
Okay.
Linebackers being back there to save the bacon.
I think. Well, I mean, that's the Denver defense actually has shown a remarkable ability to adjust to the dog walking over our head. Well, we might actually leave that in because that's kind of funny.
That is kind of funny.
Anyway, I don't know if you could pick that up. Anyway, so the Denver defense has shown a good ability to adjust to people being out a lot. And we've talked about this for the last couple of weeks about people substituting in, you know, when Porter's hurt, you know, Dumervil's hurt, these kinds of things. And that's great. You know, obviously you want all your players playing, but they have been pretty resilient about that. So
there's some depth.
There is some depth there. And that's a great thing. And so week 11 AFC picks, and this week we only have three games to do because two of the division teams are playing each other.
That's right, the Broncos and San Diego.
So, and actually that's something we noticed or looked at right before the show was, at this point in the schedule, the back half of the schedule, our division ends up playing itself or playing teams in its division quite a bit. The Broncos still have four games to do.
Right.
The Chargers still have two games to do. The Raiders and the Chiefs all have three games.
Right.
What's left of the schedule. So we're going to see a lot of each other. And this actually is an opportunity for the teams technically in contention maybe to make a move. I don't think it's happening.
Technically in contention, yes.
Yes,
technically in contention.
Nobody's eliminated yet. So
really, the bad news is, though, for San Diego, I mean, they've only got two games left, division games left. And if, San Diego does what we expect them to,
sure,
then they're pretty much out of the playoffs.
Yeah. Let's start with the Chiefs and the Bengals. We'll start from the bottom, work our way up. So I don't think this one's going to be a mystery. Actually, this is a tale of two teams that are on completely different trajectories. We didn't think of much of the Bengals 2 weeks ago,
right. But
they have played their hearts out, and they are actually playing very good football right now.
Well, I mean, they just took apart the Giants. So.
Yeah, they humiliated the Giants. They're playing well on both sides of the ball. Right now, they look bad at the start of the season. They're looking very good right now. The Chiefs have fallen to the bottom. I don't think there's a lot of mystery here. I mean, the Chiefs did play a tough game against the Steelers, but
they did.
The same old problems. Penalties, inability to convert third downs, a quarterback who the coaching staff doesn't trust to pass the ball.
Right.
The only bright spot they have is Jamaal Charles. And again, once you're one-dimensional either way, it's easy for teams to load up on you. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but personally, I'm going to say Bengals 27-13.
27-13, okay. Wow, we're pretty close on this. I'm saying that Kansas City is going to be able to net 16. I'm thinking that they're going to get at least a touchdown out of Jamaal Charles, and that he'll be able to drag them close enough to be able to get some kicks.
So you see you're calling it 27-16?
I'm saying 28-16.
28-16,
yeah,
okay.
I see Cincinnati being able to drill in for four touchdowns.
Okay, fair enough.
You know, and the real thing is, Jamaal Charles against the 20th-ranked rush defense. I mean, okay, of course, that's compiled up for the season. I think that Cincinnati's rush defense has been better, but still they're 20th-ranked. And Dalton is going against the 8th pass defense, which is kind of surprising that Kansas City is the number 8 pass defense. It's not all bad news for Kansas City.
Right.
But Dalton, you know what? I have gained a lot of respect for Dalton. Let's talk about Oakland and New Orleans.
Okay.
Now, of course, New Orleans managed to knock off the lone unbeaten team, the Atlanta Falcons. And, you know, I have been impressed with the Atlanta Falcons, but there has been this Barry Bonds asterisk hanging in the back of my head. Are they for real? Could they carry us through, a 16-0 season? And the answer is no. They are vulnerable. And in fact, their vulnerability seemed to be their own arrogance, which the New Orleans and Drew Brees, man, Drew Brees is not going to let somebody be more arrogant than him.
Sure.
So, as far as this game's concerned, I see New Orleans knocking in 42 solid points.
Okay.
And I see Oakland putting in 24. Now, the thing about it is that I think that there's an opportunity for Oakland to expose some weaknesses on the New Orleans team. I don't think the game's really going to be that close, but I think that Carson Palmer is good enough to be able to lead them down the field and get a few scores, but it's going to be for naught. It's going to be for naught. I think that New Orleans is on a mission this year to really stick their middle social finger up to the entire league and say, okay, you know what, we did a bad thing, you guys punished us harshly, but we can still come back and play.
Sure. I agree completely. I think there is a pride aspect going on with the Saints right now, especially after they started off ugly, I think is a kind word. So, and this game is pretty much, in my mind, the same as the previous game as far as where the teams are at. The Raiders, same old Raiders, as I keep saying, and they aren't going anywhere. The Raiders, I think, offensively are showing improvement for running the right plays and beating the right plays, you know, coming out and running to where you're supposed to be on the field, making it easier for Carson Palmer to throw passes. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter because they're still going to have lots of penalties. They're going to make dumb mistakes. They're going to drop the ball on the ground a lot. You know, that's the Raiders, you know, style. So, like the Chiefs, I think they're at the bottom right now. And as a team, I think they're pretty demoralized. And again, the Saints are red hot right now. And they knocked off the Falcons, and they play with, even when they were down, they were playing with a lot of pride. And I agree with you completely that Drew Brees is the X factor in these games. He's such a great quarterback. He's a consistently great quarterback.
Yeah, he's so, for real.
He is definitely for real. You know, and here's a chance for the Saints, who kind of discovered a running game last week, to run against one of the league's worst run defenses. I think the Saints could actually be a little more multidimensional. So I think the Saints win this 41. I think, like you, I'm going to give the Raiders some points, mostly because it seems like at the end of games, when things start getting a little bit away from them, they seem to wake up and start scoring points. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to make it 41-24, which is actually, what, one point
up? 41-24.
So we're pretty much on the same page in music.
That's pretty funny.
That's scary. I'm waiting for something that bad.
Yeah, and we do not discuss our picks before we sit down here. I mean, so this is completely independent research.
Yes.
All right, well, let's talk about that Denver-San Diego game. You know, yeah, I think you're going to be surprised here.
Oh.
I actually am going to call this as a close game.
Okay.
I'm going to call this a 28-24 victory for Denver.
Okay.
Now, the reason is that right now the failure of the rush is making Denver a monodimensional team.
Absolutely.
And I think that there's just enough mojo with San Diego to take advantage of that. They've got enough D to be able to punish the Broncos for being monodimensional.
Okay.
Also, last week, Carolina being able to shut down the Denver offense for nearly half the game raises some questions. What's going on there? And until the Broncos show me that they can, you know, really play well again, I'm hedging a little bit on their production. The other side of it is that it seems like Philip Rivers is always good for a pick six. And I fully expect the Denver D for one of those four touchdowns I'm predicting to be a defensive touchdown on a pick six from Rivers. I'm actually willing to put that in my prediction.
Okay.
That Denver D is going to come up with a pick six on Rivers.
You know, it's funny. When you gave me that score, I was going to comment that, oh, so you're going for the responsible Philip Rivers score. But that's interesting that you're saying that the Denver D will shut him down enough that Rivers will still throw in six. And they'll shut him down for the rest.
I gave San Diego 24 points. I think it's going to be two touchdowns. And the rest is going to be... kicks.
Okay.
And that's it.
Well, you know, continuing the harmony of the picks, I got the same concerns. Denver's offense in the last couple of weeks has shown the inability to run the ball. It makes Manning have to pass it all the time. And as great as a quarterback as Manning is, that does cause problems. And it's last week it made it hard for us against a pretty mediocre team. But again, this game, like last week's pick and the week before, that completely depends on Philip Rivers. I believe that both teams are competitive against each other. These teams don't like each other.
Right.
You know,
God knows that San Diego Chargers have ruined the Broncos' day so many times I can't count.
Absolutely. So with that in mind, you know, if Philip Rivers was a consistent quarterback,
right,
the only way I could call this game would be, oh, the home team's probably going to win this. But Philip Rivers isn't a consistent quarterback, and he's the crazy X factor. So if he's consistent, I think it'll be competitive. But I don't think he's going to be. Like you, I'm thinking, oh, he's going to throw at least one pick that'll probably go back for a touchdown or put the Broncos in a place to get 6 or 7 points. You know, and when that happens, that's a 14-point swing.
Right.
You lose your 7, and you give them 7. It's such an enormous – that's why turnovers are death to a team. I think Rivers will be inconsistent. I think he'll do the selfish thing that he always does. And I think it's going to be almost a replay of last week's game that for the Chargers. It'll be a back-and-forth game until the fourth quarter. Rivers will screw it up at some point, give up the six or the six points or the turnover that basically lets Denver, move it down themselves for the touchdown or the field goal. And that'll put the game out of the reach for the Chargers, who seem now these days just to fall apart as soon as Rivers starts through that first interception. The team doesn't seem interested in playing. And they don't even seem interested in playing when they're on the field in general. But once Rivers starts being Rivers, the team just deflates.
Yeah.
And because they don't have any – I don't think they trust him. They don't believe in him. And they just – it's the same old for them. Imagine playing for a guy in a team sport. You're playing your best games, and especially on a team where a lot of the players are on the back ends of their careers. And they're seeing that window for the going in the deep end of the playoffs getting smaller and smaller. And you do everything right. Right. And you see Philip Rivers throw an interception. You're like, crap, there goes another game.
Right.
The bottom line for this game is for the Chargers to have any chance at a playoff run at this point, they have to beat the Broncos. They lose both games to the Broncos, they're done.
They are.
It's both. So.
And conversely, I mean, let's roll back the season a little bit. To me, that incredible, pounding that we got in the first half of the game against the first game against San Diego, followed by one of the greatest point turnarounds ever in NFL history,
crazy.
Right?
Absolutely crazy. Yeah.
Exactly. So, that was kind of a turnaround in the Broncos season. We were kind of wobbling along, and then that game, and boom, we've got a winning streak that we're piling up, and we're looking like one of the top five teams in the league.
Sure. Well, you know what? Actually, I never got to my pick.
Oh.
So. I will pick the Denver Broncos to win 35-24. What was your pick?
28-24.
So we're still pretty close.
Right.
So
I mean, you're giving them another touchdown. I'm not willing to quite give them their normal 30 points this week.
Sure. So I think that does it for picks for this week. Again, only three games. The interesting thing is that we're either, for next week's, we're either going to be right or wrong together because all three of our picks were within just a few points of each other, which probably spells doom for all three of the picks. All right, so I think that'll wrap it up for Sportishness this week. So, John, Jonathan, enjoy good football. They suck. Anyway.
The thing about it, too, is that I think the organization went to some lengths to get Matt Castle.
Yes.
And, they wanted him as a quarterback of the future. And I don't know. I think I would probably be inclined to actually get rid of the coach before Matt Castle because, quarterbacks don't exactly grow on trees.
No.
But there are certainly an awful lot of pieces that need to be put in place.
Okay. No. I think that's a fair enough wrap-up.
Yeah.
Raiders versus the Saints. Actually, I should say the Raiders at the Saints to use the correct terminology. On this one, you called it 24-42. I called it 24-41. Both of us called the Saints winning this one by a pretty big margin. The final score was 17-38. So again, we were pretty close. You know, in my mind, this is like the Bengals-Chiefs game. This is definitely a game of two teams on different trajectories.
Exactly.
The Raiders aren't doing very well. They've got a lot of injuries, you know, especially in the running back end of the business. The Saints have kind of found themselves again and are playing incredibly tough football. And it was 7-21 at the half. This game was just never close. The Raiders' defense is horrible. They can't stop anything, running or passing.
Well, you know, I will say that the most interesting part of this to me, it wasn't a surprise that Oakland gave up, a couple of really important interceptions, one of which, you know, went for a score. But to me, the big story was on the New Orleans side. The fact that they actually gave up 284 yards of passing and 120 yards of rushing.
Yeah, I found the rushing stat very surprising, actually, that the Raiders could stick with it that long if they could rack up that many yards.
Yeah. So. I think it hangs an asterisk on how far we might expect New Orleans to go. I mean, they've got a tough road to hoe anyway, because, you know, they're at 5-5 this late in the season, going to be kind of a challenge to find a playoff berth.
Sure.
If they do, though, you know, that's where the asterisk comes in. What could they do in the postseason? And I think the fact that their defense, well, you know, they've got to outscore what their defense is giving up, and their defense is giving up too much. I mean, against a really good team, they would probably get obliterated.
Probably. I mean, I guess, you know, there's a couple things I did write down as highlights. You know, Carson Palmer, 3 for 312, 2 touchdowns, 2 interceptions, not very good. Of course, when you're behind, quarterbacks tend to rack up 102 yards,
right,
which is the nature of the game. But something that was interesting is, you know, they were down to a fullback as their only real viable tailback.
Yes.
19 rushes, 103 yards, and 4 receptions for 90. I mean, it's a 200-yard day for a fullback. That's that's pretty rare in the NFL these days. So, hey, you know,
no doubt.
That's something to build on. And something else I think good about Oakland this game is they only had 4 penalties.
Yes. Yeah,
that's
exactly.
A change of pace. They're usually in double digits.
Oh, yes. And in fact, against New Orleans, 11 penalties.
Yeah.
I mean, normally a team that gives up that many penalties is not going to win.
Although a couple of the Saints penalties were them going, "We just kicked your butt on great play." You know, it was a couple taunting and unsportsmanlike kind of things. But
yes,
still,
it
definitely played a lot more undisciplined than the Raiders. And that's something I think to build on for next week. They're not in a cellar, but I also know a team I don't really think is going anywhere. I don't think we have to.
Right.
Spend a ton of time on them.
Absolutely.
All right.
So getting to our favorite topic here, which is, of course, Denver. What a fascinating game that was, Denver versus San Diego.
Yeah.
Let's see. I called it at 28-24, and what did you call it?
I called it 35-24.
35-24.
And we didn't collaborate any of these picks. We just came up with these independently. But
absolutely. So, yeah, we were pretty dang close on that. DJ Williams. I'd forgotten all about DJ Williams coming in.
Right.
And so I was really fascinated to see what impact DJ Williams was going to have on the game. And I think what I saw was that he's more known as a linebacker that can really kind of stuff a run more so than be a, you know, coverage linebacker. And I think we saw some of that. I think they actually did a little bit better on their rush defense.
They did very good on their rush defense.
Although, you know, one thing that's kind of surprised me is as much criticism as I've had of the Broncos' rush defense, they're now the fifth rush defense in the league, at least for as far as yards allowed.
Okay.
So, you know. But the thing about it is having DJ Williams back is a great thing. He's a fabulous addition.
There's a lot of great things that happened in this game. The Denver defense did great. Now, this is against a Chargers offensive line that they basically picked up out of the stands right before the game. I mean, they had guys who were second, third string, shifted positions around. It was going to be a bad day for the Chargers, pretty much whoever they were going to play.
Now, we watched this game independently of one another, so I have a question for you on that. Did you see that the announcers made a deal of where Rivers was trying to call an adjustment to the line?
They were trying to slide the protection out to the edges.
Exactly, and it seemed like the line just didn't hear him or blew him off or something, but then he got dumped and he came up and he was like, Damn it, I told you to move.
I think there's plenty of blame to go around at that point. I think the center wasn't listening to the quarterback. It was kind of late, and everybody was getting set, so people stopped looking behind them, and it's hard to hear. You know. So I think this was a kind of a case of a miscommunication.
Especially Mile High Stadium. Boy, that is a hard stadium to hear in.
So, yeah, I think Rivers clearly saw the blitz coming, and the lineman didn't pick up on his signal, and that's where the fault is absolutely, I don't know. But in general, that was kind of the offensive line all day. There was a lot of miscommunications. We had a field day on Rivers. We sacked him a lot. We picked him a lot. I said last week, as I always say about Philip Rivers, do we get the good Philip Rivers or the bad Philip Rivers? Well, even though he got picked a lot and was on his back a lot, I think we basically got the good Philip Rivers, mm-hmm. except for that one early interception. It's not – I consider bad Philip Rivers quarterbacking selfish plays,
mm-hmm.
where he's just hot-dogging the ball around the field, hoping right. for a miracle.
Yeah.
Except for that one interception. And that, I can go into detail about why that play happened. That was actually brilliant on the Broncos' part. He played as good a ball as could be expected, given the offensive line he had. I think that at the end of the day, the Broncos' defense did great. We had a special teams block punt. That's all great.
Right.
But what I saw in the offense, of course, we lost our tailback for 6 to 8 weeks.
Right.
That's a huge problem for us. We did manage to run it reasonably successful the rest of the day, which was good.
Mm-hmm.
But I saw a lot of overthrown balls that game. It was I would say 6 to 8 overthrown balls that made this game a lot closer than it should have been. There was many plays where the ball just landed 3 yards outside the receiver's grasp, and then that I would say we probably gave 21 points on overthrown balls.
I can't really dig this out of the stats, but I got the impression in the game, speaking of that with overthrown balls, that I got this sense that we're having a problem sustaining drives right now.
Absolutely.
And where, a lot of our points were on quick strikes. Like there was one where I think it was the first series. I think it may have been the first series of the second quarter. We got the ball and I think that, two plays later threw it in for a touchdown. Sure. So, That seemed to be the way we scored. It was like San Diego just kind of got it out of the way of our scoring right. chances,
yes.
Rather than us grinding it down the field. That worries me right now. The other side, though, is that we 3 and outed 2 teams, across 2 games. We caused like 26
in a row.
Yeah, 26.
And they still finished up 3-13. So, you can just basically say 3-26 on third down conversions for over a 2-game span.
Yeah. That, early on in the season, we had concerns about the Denver defense not being able to get the opposing teams off the field. Well, they're doing it now.
Yes.
3 and outs are the very definition of the defense doing its job.
Yeah, I agree completely. This was again, we have a case where the entire Denver unit didn't necessarily play very well,
right.
as in all 3 phases. But when the offense is coming up short, the defense has definitely picked up the game, and vice versa. The Denver did great; they won that game. I thought they let San Diego hang around when they shouldn't have at the end of the game.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that's sustaining drives, and that has been a constant problem. So, a couple of things I really liked about this game from the metagame perspective was that John Fox did a really good job of being patient. There were a couple fourth down and short plays inside the red zone where he just said, listen, I'm going to take my 3 points.
Mm-hmm.
He did that 3 times, actually. And yeah. that added up to be the exact number of points we needed to beat.
Mm-hmm.
Beat them. And the fans were going a little crazy about that and thinking those were bad calls, And, as somebody who likes football, it's like, yeah, go for it, because it's an exciting play.
Right.
But the reality was he took 3 field goals. They made them all. And that turned out to be a difference in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, not listening to the fans, knowing the situation on the field, and doing a great job there. Otherwise, good job, Denver. And which actually I think brings us right to the next thing, which is, where does that win put us?
Where does that put us?
Well, the playoff hunt at this point, I think in the AFC West, is realistically over. We're starting to get down to these oddball things where, if it's a Tuesday and it's raining and somebody's
right.
mother brought cookies, another team can get in. But from a winning the division championship, guaranteeing a spot in the playoffs, at this point the Broncos have a 3-game numeric lead over the Chargers. But the reality is because they beat them twice, If the Chargers just tie them at the end of the season, they still don't go based on the division win.
Right.
The Chargers got to win 4 out of 6, and the Broncos have to basically lose the basically same number. I think I got it basically down here as so the AFC West playoff hunt at this point boils down to the following. So for the Broncos, it's pretty straightforward. Win any 3 of the next 6,
mm-hmm.
doesn't matter what the teams are, and you're in. And because we got 2 games against KC,
right.
that seems to make it pretty straightforward. That's all we've got to do. And in fact, the Broncos can knock the Chiefs out of the playoffs next week. Chiefs lose any games at this point, they're out.
Right.
The Chargers, they have to win 4 of the last 6, and the Broncos must lose at least 4 of the last 6, and the Raiders have to lose 2. So it's not impossible, but it depends on the Broncos losing 2/3 of their final games. The Raiders, it's pretty crazy. This is the best path to the division championship. They've got to win everything. The Broncos got to lose everything. Chargers got to lose everything. And they're in. No problem. Or they have to win at least five of the last six games, beat the Broncos. The Broncos must lose five or six. They must beat the Chargers. The Chargers must lose five or six. And that puts the whole division, except for the Chiefs, in
a partridge in a pear tree.
It puts the top three teams in division 8-8, and then we're down to tiebreakers. And yeah, it gets a little funny after that. That's not happening. The Chiefs, basically, it's really simple for them. They have to win everything. The Broncos have to lose everything. And the Chargers and Raiders got to lose the bulk of their games. Right. It's... Their season, I think, is pretty much realistically over at this point. So the Broncos do have, well, you know, the division, I think, pretty well locked up. But then it's down to, what are they going to do as far as moving up to a bye? Right now, they're the fourth-place team. They're tied with the New England Patriots at 7-3, but the Patriots have beaten us, so they win the tiebreaker. So we have to end up the season to get past the New England Patriots into the three slot. We have to have a one-game win better record than the Patriots. It's a challenge. So, but get legitimately into the bye, the top two teams are Houston at 9-1 and Baltimore at 8-2. So, Baltimore is a team that we're actually going to play. We have to win more than one more than Baltimore and beat Baltimore just to tie them.
Right.
But then the tiebreaker goes to us. So, that Baltimore game actually is getting to be more and more important by the week. Catching the Texans, that's a tough road to hoe. They're at this point, they're two games in front of us with six to play. You know, if we win out and they lose a couple on the way, it's definitely possible. But the two seed is possible, but a real challenge at this point.
The bottom line is, you know, again, you know, John and I worked on these analyses independent of one another, and you know, we've obviously seen the same kinds of things. But to me, what I like best about this season, unlike the last decade, is that we own our destiny.
Yes.
The Broncos can unless they have a ridiculous fall off in production. I mean, I think worst case scenario, rationally for me, is a 4-2 record in these remaining six games. And the fact of the matter is that there's every reason to expect that they could actually make it 6-6, that they could finish off, you know, winning every game. And that not only means, of course, in the next couple of weeks, the Broncos are going to really close out all the mathematics, or can close out all the mathematics for the division. So really, to me, all the focus is on whether they're going to get a first-round bye or not, and they're completely in charge of that, too.
Absolutely. And, you know, Baltimore, to me, is a must-win game for a couple reasons. One, it helps them get to that two spot. But another reason is chances are they're going to face Baltimore or a team as tough as Baltimore almost right away. Mm-hmm. And if you go to play Baltimore and you get blown out, well, that doesn't say a lot about the Broncos. It says that we had a really easy second half of the schedule, and yes, we can beat up on the weak sisters in the league, but we can't play with the big boys and we're not going to go deep.
Exactly.
So the Baltimore game is both strategically important for the playoff punt, but also tactically important to kind of let us know where we're at as a football team.
You know, one of the strangest things about Baltimore is, you know, they're number two in the AFC.
Right.
But they're 16th in the pass, 25th in the rush, 27th in pass defense, and 23rd in pass defense and 27th in rush defense.
Right.
So basically, we're talking about statistically a team that's in the bottom half of the league, in four major areas of the game. So how is it that they're piling up the record that they are? And to me, it speaks of a vulnerability, a place where we should be able to, you know, match our better offense against issues with their defense, and our defense ranked at number 5 and number 12 respectively, I think. Can do something pretty sweet against Baltimore and Joe Flacco.
I think there's a real opportunity there. I quite frankly wish we were playing them this weekend.
I do too.
Because they don't have, who is it, Reed is out because of that illegal hit. And they're not playing consistently good ball right now. They're kind of in a bit of disarray. So, you know, who knows how things are going to be in a couple weeks.
Right.
All right.
On to picks?
On the picks. So, all right. Do you want to run with these first?
Sure, or? I'll take the first go. All right. So, on the Oakland and Cincinnati game, I don't think there's any mystery about who's going to come on top of this game. Cincinnati has been playing tough. I see them racking up 27 points. I see Oakland being able to put together 13 points. But I think that Cincinnati has demonstrated in the last several weeks a pretty balanced defense. Statistically, they're a pretty balanced defense. And Oakland is a one-dimensional team. I mean, they are, I believe, 31st in rush. So, you know, if it weren't for Palmer's arm, they wouldn't really, you know, have a game. They'd be, you know, hugging the toilet with Kansas City right now, you know?
Sure.
So I think they're going to eat their lunch.
Okay, 27-13, that's a pretty good call. You know, to me, it's the same old Raiders, generally bad play. They did better in penalties last week, but just disorganized, throwing empty spots on the field. Their tailback situation is bad. They've got a lot of injuries. They're starting a fullback right now. And the Bengals have played hard, you know, and the Bengals are in a position right now to maybe crawl back in this if they keep playing well. And quite frankly, they've played the entire AFC West hard.
They have.
And so I'm going to call this one at 34-20, which is pretty close to
34-20,
you.
34-20, all right.
Just because the Raiders tend to rack up garbage time points pretty well for some reason. I'm not sure if the other teams are just taking it easy, but they just seem to be able to rack up an extra touchdown to you at the end of the game.
I know. I actually kind of waffled a little bit on how many points to give to Oakland. I mean, nothing close to a winning score. It's just how much the Cincinnati defense might dominate.
Yeah, it's probably going to be something like 31-13 or, you know, something in that area, pretty close to the end of the game, and they might knock in a point or two or a score or two. Chargers versus the Ravens. And I think this game actually might be a little bit closer than a lot of people think. I think a lot of people saying the Chargers are in complete disarray, the Ravens are going to stomp them. But the reality in my mind right now is both the Chargers and the Ravens have very inconsistent quarterbacks who can be selfish at times. They're not playing well offensively in general. You know, so because of the selfishness issue, you know, Flacco and Rivers, you never can tell what they're going to do.
Right.
It's hard to tell offensively which one is better any given week. It's really hard. Even with statistics, I can't figure that out. Defensively, I think the Ravens are a much better team. But the Chargers showed last week against the Broncos that they can step it up when they have to.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, the Ravens tend to play reasonably consistent defense. The Chargers, you know, statistically, they're at the bottom of the pile when it comes to defense. Last week showed up and all of a sudden made it a game. They scored 9 points on us last week. But the Chargers don't have a healthy offensive line. They've got too many substitutions. They have second string, third string players playing out of position, completely, you know, guards playing center, that kind of thing.
Right.
I think ultimately that's what gives this game the edge. I think Baltimore does win by a pretty hefty score, but I think this game will be reasonably tight till the end. I'm saying Baltimore 31 and the Chargers 17.
Hmm. You know, I see Baltimore giving Phillip Rivers fits.
I don't.
I think that they're going to be in the backfield in the pocket with him the whole game, and I think they're going to tend to be very, very aggressive against him. I mean, basically, we've shown twice this year, the Broncos have shown twice this year, that a hyper-aggressive defense can actually work well.
Yeah, they just destroyed Rivers. And again, that wasn't his fault, but
right. So the thing about it is that I really see Baltimore having Phillip Rivers on his heels. However, I also see San Diego piling up 20 points.
Okay, so what do you got there?
And Baltimore, I see doing 24 points.
Wow.
See, now, I probably spent a good 20 minutes to half an hour researching Baltimore a little bit more to try to get a better sense of how many points to give these guys. Because, you know, on one hand, they can win a 10-9 game?
Yes, 13-10, that
or
kind 13, of thing.
Yeah exactly. Sure. But on the other hand, they piled up 55 points against Oakland.
Yes.
So I don't know which team is going to show up.
Right, exactly.
So basically, I said that, you know, this is going to be a grindy fest, and with both primarily a defensive struggle with just little chinks in the armor, defensive armor, allowing the other teams to pile up, you know, 20 and 24 points.
Okay, so basically you went with the defense will, the offenses will be erratic enough that the defenses will shut them down. And I was kind of in the same thing, but figured the Chargers tend to collapse when things start going against them. So I gave them a couple extra touchdowns.
As a matter of fact, I heard that the Chargers have allowed the most points in the league right now in the fourth quarter or something like that.
It wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, it's
a Denver
bad
game, of course, skews that statistic pretty horribly.
Yes, it does. All right, and then we've got the Denver and Kansas City game. Now, you know, the easiest thing to say is that this is going to be a, you know, Denver taking Kansas City out behind the woodshed, giving them a what for. But, you know.
But we have thought that a few times this year, and it hasn't come to fruition.
Yes, and you know what? Manning said that, himself said that, that they. It would be death for them to look past Kansas City's offense and the defense. Excuse me. Their defense has actually been relatively strong, and look how they took it to you know Pittsburgh recently. So, I have absolutely no doubt the Broncos are going to win. I think that it's going to be interesting also to see. Apparently, there's a chance that Brady Quinn. Our former backup quarterback, of course, could be their starting quarterback, and that could be interesting. Yeah, I mean, I've actually never seen Brady Quinn play, so nice to, you know, after you know being a bench warmer for 2 years, it'll be nice to finally see the guy air out a ball.
It really sucks in sports to play left out.
Oh, God, I know. you know, the thing about it, too, is that for me, the really big story, again, is DJ Williams coming back to the lineup. I really think that he has been a missing ingredient for particularly for the pass defense. And, you know, they're trying to figure out right now how exactly to use him. You know, he prefers to play, you know, weak side or strong side, typically weak side. He'll probably get weak side roles. But the thing about it is Woodyard has been playing really well on the weak side. And, of course, you know, Von Miller's been playing strong side. So you're not going to, you know, you're not going to mess with Miller. You don't want to, you know, mess with the success that Woodyard's having too much. So it could be that, you know, he's going to get slotted in on, you know, certain kinds of situations. I am absolutely blown away by what a remarkable defense we have. I mean, Miller, Dumervil, Woodyard, Williams, and Brookings and Trevathan have been doing pretty well too. And you know, Trevathan has been a really important. You know, as a rookie, he's been an important mix in the linebacker core. And I think it's only going to get stronger. In fact, I'm kind of with Mark Klee of the Denver Post right now. That I think that in the end, it's going to be the defense led by the performance of Von Miller that could have more of an influence on Denver's chance at a Super Bowl than Mr. Manning.
Defenses win championships. It's an oldie but a goodie. It's generally true.
So anyway, I'm sorry. I went way out there, but bottom line is I see Denver racking up 38 points. I see Kansas City barely being able to muster 10. It could quite possibly be less than that.
Okay.
Because I think that the defense is going to smother them, which is why I went out on that whole diatribe about Williams' contribution to the defense.
Sure. You know, I think for this game, in my mind, the game will be decided probably off the field for a couple things. One, the fans have given up completely on the team and the coaching staff. You know, they're wearing black to games now. You know, they're like in mourning. So the question then becomes, off the field, does the team have any pride in itself? Is it going to try to win this game? Is it going to try to play the royal spoiler, which is really realistically the only thing they have left to play for at this point? Will they play for Crennel at the end of the day is the bottom line. Mm-hmm. I don't think so. They haven't to date. You know, they showed a spark of life 2 weeks ago.
Right.
But last week, they just collapsed being back to their regular self. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's a big question. Also, you don't keep switching quarterbacks every half because you don't like the quarterback's performance. You make a decision and you stick with it. If the guy stinks, you take the new guy out, you put the old guy back in, and that's the end of the conversation. You don't go, you know, back and forth between your two starting quarterbacks. Now, they had a concussion thing that, you know, that changed from Castle to Quinn and back and forth.
Right.
But last week, they changed the quarterbacks at halftime, and now they have not announced a starter. No offensive unit likes that. No quarterback, no athlete ever likes being jerked around like that. And that speaks more to the problems in the front office and the coaching staff of the Chiefs and control of their own team than anything. So I don't think they're showing up to play.
Yeah.
And I don't think the fans care enough about the team that the players are going to play to them. That happens sometimes in sports. You know, mm-hmm. Listen, we've stunk it up, but hey, these guys are paying good money. We need to go out there and kick some butt. When the fans turn against you, the whole thing is sour. Nobody's happy. Like you, I don't think the Chiefs have a chance. The only question I really have about – I have two questions about the Broncos. Can they run the ball? That's going to be a challenge. Another thing is, can they stop fumbling the ball? Good Lord. It's just like every time like I see a run back, I'm like, that's going to be fumble because people aren't running the ball. Every time I see a run break for a bit and the guy's dancing, it's going to be a fumble. They've got to get that under control. Last week, they only lost one of those, but it
could have gone another way.
It could have gone another way on them. The reality for the Chiefs, if they lose this game, they're mathematically eliminated for the playoffs. You've got no chance. So, again, are they playing for a playoff spot? I sincerely doubt it. But the Broncos have the opportunity here to knock them out of the park. I'm saying Denver will go actually above their normal 30 range and go to 41.
Okay.
And the Chiefs will manage to get 13 points.